Mark Josephson, aside of being an outstanding investigator, he was a fantastic person, actually a very interesting character. If you do artificial intelligence and you look at his face, you will see that he had two personalities, integrated personalities. On one hand, he was an insightful thinker. On the other hand, he was very spontaneous and vocal. As a second aspect, he was very human, but he was critical. And most of the time, he was right. And then, like most of the electrophysiologists, he actually was a very hardworking person, very hardworking, but very talkative. This is what made him to be a great educator. And he knew everybody. Well, an unforgettable person. He was a great friend, and I really appreciate this opportunity for presenting this lecture to you in the name of Mark Josephson. I was asked to talk about what do we think is right or we know about myocardial injury in COVID patients and what we think we should know. I took a compromise, and this is my title. What do we think we know? We may be right, we may be wrong. But I'm going to address the subject, the complex subject, in four different ways. We are going to talk about a moment about the virus, injury as measured by troponins, the impact in the heart, particularly in the myocardium, and then in the coronary arteries. And let me start with the virus in itself. We got the experience here of about 7,000 patients COVID positive and near 200 autopsies. And this paper is going to be published soon, which is the four stages of the disease as we view it. Stage one, the virus entry, it multiplies in the respiratory system. In 40% of the people, the virus stays there, no symptoms. Then we have a second stage in which the virus enters into the circulation and circulates without affecting organs, typical of having some fever, not feeling well, fatigue, and these individuals in general are not hospitalized. Then we have the most severe form, or severe form, which is stage three, in which there's an inflammatory component, a very aggressive inflammatory component, trying to counteract the virus. And such inflammatory component actually triggers the clotting system. And finally, this component that is inflammatory actually breaks the cells of the vasculature, and then the endothelium is gone and thrombosis can take place. So these are four important stages that we will talk more about in a moment. And this is what I mentioned about the inflammatory component outside the vasculature. It can trigger blood clotting by itself. And if this inflammation is very aggressive, they may destroy the endothelium, and such destruction makes tissue factor to enter. So a direct procoagulant activity, an indirect procoagulant activity. Having said this, let me now go into the important stage of injury assessed by troponin levels and also the role in survivorship. And this is a study that we just published. And basically, were 3,000 COVID positive patients, in which here we have in red are the dots of those who had previous cardiovascular disease, and in blue, no previous cardiovascular disease. In the vertical axis, troponins, in the horizontal axis, the days of follow-up. And as you can see, even at follow-up, troponins could be actually increased, particularly in those patients who are in red or those who had previous cardiovascular disease. And this is the role of troponins or the association actually with mortality. Just to say that in the overall population of near 7,000 patients, 36% in our study had positive troponins. And the 36% now was also in half of the patients, which were about 3,000, the first that we began to study. And here's the survivorship. This is actually high troponin level, mildly elevated, and this is normal. And this has to do with survivorship. So there's no question that troponins and the levels had to do with survivorship in patients COVID positive that were hospitalized. And this is the same data. This is mortality according to the levels of troponins. This is normal, moderately abnormal, more mortality, increased mortality, significantly abnormal, increased mortality. And what this means, discharge of the patient in blood. Sure, these are discharged, low mortality, and here with high mortality, the number of patients being discharged is much less. In fact, the mortality was almost 60% in the highest levels of troponin. And this is actually, other studies all show the same thing. This is a study from China, actually, two studies, and troponin positives, you see mortality 60%, in the other study 51%, normal troponins 5%, 9% mortality. So the relationship between troponins and mortality, as you can see, is across the board. And in these two studies, the number of patients who had positive troponin, in one study 28%, in the other 20% COVID positive patients, in our study, as we mentioned, over 30%. But there is another aspect that was interesting, and this is in a number of studies, and that is when troponins begin to go up as the days go, the mortality also significantly increases, even with levels of troponins that are not extremely high. So a progressing increase in troponin levels is bad news. Well, having said this, in the relationship between troponins and survivorship, let's now move what happens into the myocardium. And let's now concentrate in the myocardium, not in the coronary arteries. And let's spend a minute to give at least a view of the slide. The myocardium may be affected by three different aspects. One is chronic myocardial injury. In fact, can happen with COVID after they have recovered, at least symptomatically. And we mentioned this before. This is injury of the myocardium with acute non-ischemic myocardial injury. And this is acute myocardial infarction. Now, here in the bottom are the results. These patients with chronic myocardial injury may have chronic heart failure, cardiomyopathy, hypertension, chronic COVID-positive patients. Not necessarily all are COVID. But here we have a very important aspect, acute non-ischemic myocardial injury, very, very important. A primary cardiac illness, and that is this is affecting the myocardium directly. And here the heart is not affected by anything, but there is shock, for example, or sepsis and so forth. And you could say it's a myocardial injury, but certainly is not because of primary effect into the myocardium. This could be a secondary effect, pulmonary embolism, again, critical illness, sepsis, and so forth. And this is acute myocardial infarction that we will be talking later. In color means, green means, well, not so bad. In yellow means we have to think about it. And in red is bad news. This is really the protagonist of myocardial injury in patients with COVID positive. Certainly, as you will see in a moment, about 70% of the injuries relate to these processes. And here they are. Myocarditis, non-specific, direct viral injury, stress cardiomyopathy, Takotsubo, acute heart failure, arrhythmias, atrial and ventricular. Let me talk about this because it's very important. Are we dealing with an inflammatory process that non-specifically causes injury of the myocardium? Or is the virus that directly causes the injury? I'm going to address here three aspects that are of interest. How complex echocardiography may be in these patients. They can come from different venues. In these cases, actually, the patients in the group in Edinburgh by Dr. Dweck and others were the patients with COVID. About, you can see, 40% was a normal echocardiogram, 60% was abnormal, left ventricle, right ventricle, or a combination of both. And these patients had clinical indications for echocardiography, but this is what it happened. And here we are now going to pull together echocardiography and other aspects, particularly troponins. And this is our study. is going to be published soon. Similarly, in this case, all had injury, biomyocardial positive, 190 patients, 60% of the injury patients actually had positive echo. Like in the previous study, it was an indication of echo, perhaps because troponins were high or other biomarkers. Left ventricular wall motion abnormalities, global ventricular dysfunction, right ventricular dysfunction of the diastolic dysfunction. So here we have even pericardial effusion. This is actually what you see in the majority of cases that have echocardiographic abnormalities. But here's the question: what about if we put troponins, and this is again our study, what about if we put troponins together with the issue of echocardiography? Well, let's go to the bottom. Myocardial injury with transthoracic echocardiography abnormalities. Bad news. Significant mortality. What about if we have myocardial injury without echo abnormalities? Better. And here there is no myocardial injury. So, in fact, when myocardial injury is affecting the myocardium, as we see in 60% of the patients, echocardiographically speaking, you have both, the news are not good. And here now we enter into something interesting, and that is the recovery period. And in the recovery period, let's now again put together, in this case, also troponins, a new technology, magnetic resonance imaging. Well, this is a study by the group in Frankfurt of 100 patients. And in these patients, you see that of those who actually were recovering of these 100, a number of them, whether was still hospitalized or not, had high sensitive troponin levels. So the patients may do a little bit better, but there is something getting into the chronic stage. And this is actually MRI, the T1 edema or fibrosis or the T2 edema. Here you have a normal MRI in a number of patients out of the 100, maybe 15%, in which there are abnormalities that are significant. Because when we talk about edema, we still talk about acute or subacute disease. And this is without going into too much detail. These are patients who have edema or fibrosis, and in this particular part of the slide, and here is fibrosis alone. And that is, these were patients who actually were recovering out of the 100. And this is the study in Frankfurt. And most importantly, once you have an abnormal echocardiogram or an abnormal MRI, the possibility that you are dealing with acute lymphocytic approach or deposition of lymphocytes or their antigens is very high. So this is not virus. This is just probably the inflammatory process causing the injury. In the majority of cases, that in fact we talk about myocardial injury. And this is the group of Wuhan in China showing the same information about MRI. And some of these patients at the recovery phase, they had edema or fibrosis, a number of them. And they were able to tabulate what regions of the heart were affected by edema or by fibrosis. Again, this is bad news, and that is we have patients COVID positive. They are in the hospital and it's fine, but a number of patients leave the hospital and maybe a small proportion can have MRI at that time and they still may show changes. And so the serum troponin levels are still elevated. It's a small proportion, as I say, but it's real. And this leads to acute heart failure. Acute heart failure actually is an issue that we address. We have 6,000 patients with a history of heart failure, some with reduced ejection fraction, some with middle range reduced ejection fraction, and preserved ejection fraction. And these were 6.6% of our patients. 93% did not have previous heart failure. COVID positive affects all these patients, but there's one thing, those who actually were admitted, as we mentioned, with high troponins and COVID positive, these are the ones that the hazard ratio is significantly higher than those that we saw that actually did not have inflammation and they were actually doing fine and they didn't have even previous cardiovascular disease. So this slide actually is a combination of previous cardiovascular disease, troponin levels that are positive, and the patients have a higher mortality than those who did not have cardiovascular disease and have actually troponin negative. And interesting, of these patients with heart failure, there is no distinction in mortality, whether it is heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, with middle level the reduced ejection fraction, or with ejection fraction that is actually normal. Again, all these patients had previous heart failure. I want to emphasize this. What about arrhythmias? Well, first of all, in our original study that we did with 3,000 patients, there was a relationship between atrial fibrillation and troponins. As troponins increase, the atrial fibrillation increases. It was an average of about 8% of the patients with atrial fibrillation, but with more levels as the troponins were going high. And this is the group of Vivek Reddy. In fact, we have here near 4,000 patients with COVID. These are having near 1,500 patients with influenza, but at different time, the COVID was in February to April of 2020. The other influence was actually a registry in about 2017, 2020, before COVID. And this is the patients that actually we were look in terms of atrial fibrillation. And just to say, in the first group of COVID, 10% had atrial fibrillation and 6% was new. And in the influenza was 12%. So the atrial fibrillation is very similar in both. But there are differences in terms of survivorship. In the atrial fibrillation, as you can see, the patients who you see here in the bottom is atrial fibrillation with COVID positive, no atrial fibrillation with COVID positive, and here is influenza. Influenza with atrial fibrillation, influenza with no atrial fibrillation. So there is a difference. The incidence of atrial fibrillation is the same, but actually there is a significant difference whether it is atrial fibrillation or not between each of the two groups. So mortality going higher or in this direction, survivorship being better and better as the patient having influenza and no atrial fibrillation. In other words, having COVID and atrial fibrillation. And this leads to ventricular arrhythmias or significant arrhythmias. The overall literature says that actually in well-monitored patients, in about 17-20%, they may have ventricular tachycardia or ventricular fibrillation that has been identified. These are in the group of Vivek Reddy, 800 patients, consecutive patients with COVID positive, and 140 were on telemetry, 88 were discharged, 52 actually died. And what is very important is the overall malignant arrhythmias were 9%, all monitored, but were 17% in those who actually died and were actually much less of 3% in those who actually were alive and discharged. So there is a relationship, obviously, between mortality and malignant arrhythmias, and I think all relates to the degree of ischemia, as we have been saying. And now, finally, acute myocardial infarction. In acute myocardial infarction, you will say, we say this pandemic is very pro-clotting and is a problem. Well, we are not entirely sure. It may be, it may be not. But this is the final issue that I want to address. Here we have a very good study in which was done in the Barts Heart Center in London. And it is interesting that over a long period of time, March 1st to May 20th, there were 115 patients with myocardial infarction. 39 were COVID positive. Actually, not many. What happened to these patients compared with those who were not COVID positive? Mortalities increase. This is COVID positive. This is not. And intensive care admission is increased. And in the non-COVID is not. And the question is, what they found is more thrombosis in the COVID-19 than in non-COVID-19, and multivessel thrombosis, and the thrombosis was more dense. So the question is these COVID patients perhaps were going to have a myocardial infarction, but when they get it, once they get it, it gets worse? Or is COVID by itself moving towards a myocardial infarction? Whatever it is, the incidence is not high. And this leads to the concept that in fact we have microvascular dysfunction probably is much more important with the small clots, as we have seen at autopsy, in the myocardium in patients COVID positives, that actually a clot in the main coronary arteries. And this is what we have been saying. The damage Most of the damage comes from the inflammation, and we do not believe that the virus, there are cases reported, are really the cause of such injury. And this leads to the final point that I want to make. This, we are at the end stage of the disease, all lots of medications to address the virus in itself. But here we have inflammation. What about the steroids? I'm not going to talk about it, but what about antithrombotics? Since actually it's the inflammation in the thrombus which causes the death of these patients. And this is actually what we have done. We had two patients with deep venous thrombosis at the beginning of the endemia. And then what we did is we look at these patients and we observe, and we just published this, that in 5,000 patients, when we gave six different types of anticoagulants, three of the types, subcutaneous heparin therapeutic, subcutaneous heparin prophylactic, and apixaban, the therapeutic, the mortality decreased by 50%. This is actually a study, it is an observational study. But this has led to an international clinical trial in which we started. We are engaging about more than 100 institutions across the world, and we are actually testing the three types of anticoagulation in a randomized study. And the important issue here is we don't have a placebo. Frankly, after our observation study and seeing that these three regimes actually work, even being observational, we just don't feel right to do a placebo approach with antithrombotic therapy. And this is basically the primary endpoints, composite of all-cause mortality and others, and then primary safety, of course, in terms of bleeding. I finish by saying, first, thank you very much for having given me this opportunity related to an unforgettable person, a fantastic investigator, and a very good human being. The talk was, what do we think we know? This is what I said to you. There are many things that I said that maybe will be different in a few months, and there are many things that we didn't say that will become very important in a few months. But at least I tried to give you a sense that myocardial injury is a real problem that can cause and can lead to mortality. And most importantly, I think it relates to the inflammation. But the mortality in itself relates to the inflammatory process and to the thrombotic process. Thank you very much. Again, I am very appreciative of all of you. Thank you.